Hello, welcome all of you to this lecture video. Here I am going to explain material science, which comes under module 5 of engineering physics prescribed by video. So here I am going to explain the following points, that is free electron concept, drift velocity, Drude-Lorentz theory or classical free electron theory, and then mean free path lambda, mean collision time tau, and also the relaxation time tau r. So first I am going to take up what is free electron theory concept. As according to classical free electron theory or Drude-Lorentz theory, a metal is supposed to consist of positive metal ions. They are fixed in their respective min position and whose valence electrons are moving freely within the boundaries of the metal, and they collide with each other and also with the lattice points. These free electrons are responsible for the conduction of electricity, and hence they are called conduction electrons. Due to the temperature, as you raise the temperature of the material, the metal ions vibrates about their respective mean position. When the temperature increases, the amplitude of vibration also increases. So these vibrations keeps the electrons moving constantly within the boundaries of the metal. If you raise the temperature of the material, the interaction of electron with the lattice points increases, and hence the resistance suffered by the material for the flow of electrons increases. That's why as you raise the temperature of a material, that is especially conductors, the resistance offered by the conducting material increases. So this is what about the free electron concept. And if you look at the electron movements, they keep on moving within the boundaries of the metal and collide with each other and also with the lattice points. Based on this, let us concentrate on what is mean free path lambda. So mean free path lambda is nothing but the average distance traveled by the electrons between successive collisions with the lattice points. So for example, let us consider the movement of an electron. So between first collision, let lambda 1 be the distance traveled by the electron. For the second collision, let lambda 2 be the distance traveled. Similarly, for the third collision, let lambda 3 be the distance traveled. If we consider n number of collisions, then the value of lambda is given by lambda is equal to lambda 1 plus lambda 2 plus lambda 3 plus up to lambda n divided by n. So that is what the value of lambda. So the average distance traveled by the electron between successive collision with the lattice sites is known as mean free path, denoted by symbol lambda. And similar to this, we can explain what is mean collision time, denoted by symbol tau. So mean collision time is the average time that elapses between successive collisions with the lattice sites. So let us consider the case of an electron. Let T1 be the time taken by the electron between two successive collisions, and let T2 be the time taken for the next collision. Similarly, T3 be the time taken for the another collision. So if there are n collisions are taken into account, then the mean collision time tau is equal to T1 plus T2 plus T3 plus up to Tn divided by n. So in this way, we can able to calculate what is mean collision time tau. Next, I am going to explain what is relaxation time tau r. So in the absence of an external electric field, the electrons are all moving in all directions, and the probability of an electron finding in a definite direction is found to be same by finding another electron moving in the opposite direction. So the average velocity, if we consider, let it be VAV, that will become zero for an electron in the absence of external electric field by considering a particular direction. If you apply electric field, by that time all the electrons gets diverted in a direction opposite to the direction of applied field. Let VAV dash be the average velocity of the electrons in a direction opposite to the direction of applied field. So the average velocity VAV is equal to VAV dash in the presence of applied field. Now when the field is switched off or turned off, what happens to the average velocity? So when you remove the applied field, suddenly the average velocity of the electron in a direction opposite to the direction of applied field reduces exponentially and finally reaches zero. So as according to the graph shown here, if we plot a graph of average velocity VAV versus time t, then the average velocity reduces from VAV dash and finally reaches zero as shown in the graph. And it will be expressed mathematically as VAV is equal to VAV dash into e to the power of minus t by tau r. Here t is the time counted from the instant the field is turned off, and tau r is known as relaxation time. If we equate tau r is equal to t, then the equation takes this format, that is VAV is equal to VAV dash into e to the power of minus 1, or VAV is equal to 1 by e times e to the power of, that is 1 by e times VAV dash. So this is the final format of the equation. So based on this, relaxation time is nothing but time taken by the electrons to reach the directional velocity, which is equal to 1 by e times its value by the time the field is turned off. So this is the way of explaining the relaxation time tau r. Now I am going to explain what is drift velocity. So on the application of external electric field, the electrons moves in a direction opposite to the direction of applied field. This type of motion is known as drift motion, and the velocity acquired by the electrons by that time is known as drift velocity, denoted by symbol Vd. So the drift velocity Vd is given by small e into capital E by m into tau. So E is charge on the electron, capital E is the strength of the applied field, m is mass of the electron, and tau is mean collision time. So this is what the expression for drift velocity. And now I am going to give you the assumptions of classical free electron theory or Drude-Lorentz theory. So there are four assumptions. First assumption is, in a metal there is large number of free electrons moving freely within the boundaries of the metal. That is the first assumption. And second assumption is, these free electrons are assumed to behave like gas molecules and also assumed to obey the laws of kinetic theory of gases. So if you consider this concept into account, the mean kinetic energy of an electron, that is given by 3 by 2 kT, where K is Boltzmann constant and T is the temperature. And if you consider a gas molecule of mass m moving with velocity v, the kinetic energy is given by half mv square. So here we can equate 3 by 2 kT is equal to half mv square. And the third assumption is, the electric field produced by ionic cores is assumed to be constant, and it is similar by all the positive metal ions, and it is uniform throughout the body of the metal. And the repulsion between electrons is totally neglected. So this is what the third assumption. That means the electric field produced by positive ions is found to be constant throughout, and the repulsion between the electrons is totally neglected. And the fourth assumption is, on the application of external electric field, the electric current in a metal is mainly due to drift motion of electrons. So this is what the fourth assumption. Now I am going to explain what is the failures made by classical free electron theory. Even though classical free electron theory is successful in explaining electrical conductivity, thermal conductivity and other concepts, but it is failed to explain specific heat and temperature dependence of electrical conductivity sigma, and the third one is dependence of electrical conductivity on electron concentration. So these were all the three concepts taken into account in order to identify the failures made by this theory. So now I am going to consider specific heat. Specific heat is denoted by symbol CV. So specific heat is nothing but the quantity of heat required to raise the temperature of a metal, that is 1 mole of a metal, through 1 degree Kelvin. So specific heat is nothing but quantity of heat required to rise the temperature of 1 mole of a substance through 1 degree Kelvin. So what is 1 mole of a substance? 1 mole can be defined as a substance which contains Avogadro number of atoms. So this is what about specific heat. So as according to classical free electron theory, the specific heat CV is equal to 3 by 2 times R, where R is gas constant. But experimentally, it is observed that the value of CV is equal to 10 to the power of minus 4 RT, where R is gas constant, T is the given temperature. So here you are finding failure. Next, the dependence of electrical conductivity on temperature. So as according to classical free electron theory, the value of sigma is proportional to 1 by root T, that is temperature, 1 by root T. So as according to experiment, the value of sigma is proportional to 1 by T. So here the theory fails. So initially, as according to classical free electron theory, that is sigma is proportional to 1 by root T, but experimentally it is 1 by T only. And the third concept is dependence of electrical conductivity on electron concentration. So here electron concentration is denoted by symbol N. So it is nothing but the number of free electrons per unit volume of the material. So the electrical conductivity sigma is proportional to N as according to classical free electron theory, but experimentally this equation not valid. So the electrical conductivity is not depends on electron concentration, but some other things are responsible for electrical conductivity of a metal. That's what the concept. So these were all the three failures identified under classical free electron theory. So in the next video, I am going to give you the quantum free electron theory and also how it is successfully explaining the failures of classical free electron theory.